Hi, and welcome to another episode of the Carpenters Q&A. I'm Chris May. Today I have a very special interview lined up with Carpenters harpist Gayle Levant and English horn oboist Earle Dumler, neither of which are strangers to the Carpenters catalog. They've both played on many, many cherished and beloved Carpenters recordings, but their work didn't stop there. They have contributed to a wide array of recordings, movie soundtracks over the years that we all are familiar with, and I think this is going to be fun, and I think it is certainly worth celebrating these two. So without further ado, let's jump into that interview. Gayle and Earle, it's a pleasure to have you both here. I've really looked forward to doing this. And Gayle, you and I ran into each other several months ago at the Wallace celebrating Richard with Steinway.
That's right.
That was great. And that's what gave me the idea to do this. And Earle and I, of course, both being from the desert there, my wife and I have since moved, but we kept trying to get together. And I admitted I was the big flake and we just never happened, but here we are. And so I just want to sort of jump into this. And I think that this will be fun. So, really, I want to start with your careers in Hollywood. Where, and maybe Gayle, if you want to, we'll start with you. I'll ask the question and then we can tip it to Earle. But what led you to Hollywood? And do you remember the year, or kind of right around the year, that you got started as a first call studio musician?
I have a legacy with my father, who was a wonderful, wonderful violinist and was concertmaster here in Hollywood in the studios in the 30s and the 40s. And he had an untimely death in 1950 when he was 41 years old. So right from the time I was 2-3 years old, my dad was concertmaster at Disney. He had been concertmaster. He was gonna be concertmaster at MGM, Paramount. I'm just trying to think of all the different studios, Republic, RKO. Anyway, so from the time I was a very little girl and my dad would be at Disney and he'd come home with these wonderful stuffed animals, not animals, but all the characters, Disney characters. And I started the piano at 3. I started the harp at 11. My dad had already passed away. By the time I was 13, I knew I wanted to follow in his footsteps. And I wrote a term paper in my English class about that. Music is my world. And I never had a desire to go to be a soloist and travel around the world, or to be a symphony player, or to be a pit player. And they're all fantastic careers for all the musicians. But I wanted to follow in my dad's footsteps. So my first time being in a studio actually was when I was about 16, playing piano with a rhythm section for the stage play, The Boyfriend. And we had done it in school. And then we went into the studio to record it. And I was completely hooked. I mean, there was just no question that's what I was gonna do. So then I was 17 or 18 years old, and my stepfather, who was a producer and director, had done a commercial for Exide Batteries? I think it was. And he took me into the studio to record harp for it. Then shortly after that, I had done a commercial for SFO Helicopter, San Francisco. And I must have been 18 or 19. And I remember driving home and hearing it on the radio. I was driving back from playing in a community orchestra. I was taking the harp out to Riverside. And then on my way home, I heard the commercial. And I just something about being in a studio, if we're blessed, especially in today's way that we record, but throughout the years to have a full orchestra around me, or to be a part of a full orchestra and hear that sound, or whether I'd be overdubbing and improvising solo harp, it's just something that has never been a job for me. It's been my passion. It's my joy. My husband says to me, whenever you go to a session, you look like you're going to your very first session, because I bounce out with such a, you know, to go down the stairs with such a happy heart, because I can't wait to get there and see how I can help make it better. So that I really got myself started. I got started around 1965 and 66. And I was being called in to do record sessions and with rhythm sections, because I just have an understanding of harmony and chords from the piano. And I think the piano, when I'm playing the harp, I've always got the keyboard is always in front of me and my eyes visually. Yep. And that's when my career had basically got started in studios. And I remember one of the first big sessions that I had done, and I didn't know all the musicians. It was a session at RCA, and it was for Andre Previn with Julie Andrews. Mm-hmm. And it was her Christmas album. And Julie was standing right next to Andre at the podium. I was dead center right in front of him, and then the orchestra just all spread out left and right. And that was exhilarating. I knew where I was where I was supposed to be, and my heart was so full. And that's, you know,
great school.
That's kind of where I started. I remember the first time walking onto an actual major studio lot, whether I can't remember if it was MGM or whatever it was, and thinking to myself, oh my God, I'm on this lot, I'm walking to the scoring stage. You know, I still feel that way.
That's great. Well, it's a passion. How about you, Earle?
I wanted to be the first oboe in the Boston Symphony. That's what I wanted to do. And I actually went to school in Boston. My first union job was subbing with the Boston Symphony. When I left school, I went to Norfolk, Virginia. They were just starting that orchestra to become a professional orchestra. And the summer before I went there, I had a friend that was associated with the Stan Kenton Clinics. And he said to me, I was at home at that time in Kansas. And he said to me, what are you doing next week? And I said, nothing. And he said, well, why don't you come to California and go to the Kenton Clinics with me? Bring your baritone saxophone. Mm-hmm. So I did. And then I went back. I went to Virginia, and I was there, was teaching at Virginia State, and I was playing in the orchestra. And I got a call from the road manager of the Kenton Band wanting me to go on the road playing baritone and bass saxophone. And it just sounded exciting. So I did it. I went from a very good job. We're talking 1967. And I went for what paid very well at that time, and in a town that was very inexpensive, to $150 a week on the road. Yeah. And after two tours with the Kenton Band, I ended up in Los Angeles. And one of the guys, the drummer on the band at the time, named Dee Barton, started a band in Los Angeles, and a lot of the guys that had been on the Kenton Band were in that band. And Herbie Alpert came in and heard us playing at Dante's one night and loved the band. And they were just finishing the studios at A&M, and they wanted to tune A&M Studio A. And so he asked us to come in and rehearse in that studio so they could get a sound. And he liked the music so much that he offered Dee a contract, and Phil Spector hired a number of us to a letter from Phil Spector on the wall over here. So he hired a number of us to play some stuff. But the first real recording session that I did independently and I do not remember the name of the tune, but it was just me sweetening a song with the Mamas and the Papas. And I still remember it was in that little room on the side of Western Studios. I don't know, it was a couple of years after the Carpenters really became well known. Sure. in the country. I got a call. Jules Chaikin was the contractor at A&M Records, and he had heard me play and hired me to come in and play. The first thing I did with the Carpenters was Flat Broke.
Oh, you remember? Okay, yeah.
Yep. And it was that was strictly an instrumental. That was a featured Richard. And that's actually what launched my career, because they gave me album credit like I was part of the group. And it's not really well known, but Hollywood has a tendency to listen with its eyes.
Yes, they do. Yes.
Well, and, you know,
I mean, but to your credit, there were some other recordings on that album that have, you know, obviously stood the test of time that you played on, and you were a regular. Not only on those, but remember now, of course, you know, and people, especially fans of any group, really have a tendency to look through the other end of the looking glass. You know, they look back. And so a lot of the recordings that had, as we talked about before we jumped into the interview, you know, they had some other woodwind instrument on the original track. Rich, of course, replaced a number of those as he went about tweaking things after Karen died, excuse me. And you're on those. And so that's, you know, really even a couple of years prior to 72, which is the year you're talking about, some of those recordings you're actually on now, years later. So it really is kind of funny how technology works in regard to that. But Gayle, you actually started recording with the Carpenters right from the get-go. I think you're on those contracts right in mid-69.
Yeah, whenever it started. And then I just know that I was just taken with the sound that I was hearing. Yeah. I mean, Richard's arrangements were fantastic. And I think it was in 71, maybe 72, Karen and Richard got invited to go perform up at Harrah's Club in Lake Tahoe. And they took their core group and they asked me to go with them. And at the time, Jimmy Getzoff was the violinist who'd been playing Concertmaster on the records. And they asked him. So the two of us also went up and we had a great time. And Karen was still playing drums at the time. You know, so she performed from the drums. Mm-hmm. I mean, while she was singing, she was playing the drums during that show. It was wonderful. So yeah, right back from the beginning with Karen and Richard.
Sure. Do you remember, kind of a technical question while I'm thinking about it, particularly in the early days, because A&M, they then went through sort of a big overhaul when they built Studio D and like right around 74. I know we're going back a lot of years, so, you know.
That's okay.
Although I'm not setting you guys up with these questions. Did they isolate you when you were in with the strings? I mean, did they either baffles or did they try to move you? Because they didn't have an action.
I was pretty much.
Huh?
Yeah, very, very seldom would I be like in an ISO booth. I was in the room with the strings, and sometimes it would be an orchestra with, and I remember Earle being there with when we were in Studio A. Remember, Hal Blaine would be on drums, and we'd have, you know, full orchestra.
Wow.
The largest orchestra I ever remember Richard using, and Earle, I'm sure you were there too. We actually did the Christmas album.
Yep.
And Richard had brought in Peter Knight, and we were on the shooting stage at A&M, which was huge.
Right.
And we had a big orchestra for that one. Yep. But the size orchestra he used for the sound that he wanted was, it wasn't huge, but most of the time we played live. A lot of times I was sweetening with strings, but yeah.
Right. The first time you both intersect on a recording is on Superstar. That one has made its way around the globe many, many times. And not only with the hit that the Carpenters had with it in 71, but, you know, Tommy Boy, which is a film that came out, Lorne Michaels' film. Interesting story behind how that ultimately got authorized to be in the film. But, you know, there was sort of this resurgence again with the people that had seen the film. You know, there's that scene where they're singing, you know, "Don't you remember you told me you love me, baby," and they're crying and this. But it's a brilliant, it's a great song. It's a brilliant arrangement. And it opens with the harp, and then in comes the oboe, which Earle, the original track in 71 was recorded by Jim Horn, but Jim really wasn't an oboist. And I know that was one of the first things that Richard had you redo.
I was just thinking, you mentioned Jim Horn, and Jim Horn's claim to fame as an oboist is "I Got You, Babe."
Oh, okay. Well, that's kind of what it sounded like on the 71 album too. It was not, as I said, very sort of obligato. There's really not much to it. And then, you know, in comes Earle. And Richard, I mentioned it in the discography, in the book that we did. You know, he considers you one of the top five worldwide, which is, I think, I mean, not that he had to tell us that, but that's impressive.
But he's right.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I remember when we did Superstar, was it 71 you said?
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the record, I think there's very nice harp arpeggio thing that...
C minor.
Richard hadn't written. That was my thing. I just loved to throw in what I wanted to do. And that was just my doing that at the end.
That's one thing that I will say that he's good at. It, for as much as he is a perfectionist, because it's very difficult to self-produce and arrange and be the artist. I mean, usually you're way too close to the subject matter to be objective. And I think that it's interesting because that he always selected the musicians that he knew were going to give him what he wanted. It didn't matter how many times he may have asked for a retake. He knew. That, you know, and even in terms of ad-libbing, when there was some freedom, and I want to ask you about that in a second, you know, how much ad-lib did you guys get? How much freedom did you get to do that sort of thing? Because again, that's, you're contributing to the sound.
Not a lot. Yeah, not a lot. Because,
tell us how
you believe. Because he knew what he wanted. Earle, don't you agree? Not a lot.
Oh, there's a school of oboe playing from Philadelphia that is it's very stylistic and I love it. It's a very free kind of playing and stuff and so I would come in and read a tune. And by the way, most of the stuff that I did, I did do some full orchestra stuff, but most of the stuff I did alone. It was just me sweetening.
Right.
And you know, I'd come in and I'd play this thing and that's the style that I like. And Richard said, could you tighten that up rhythmic a little bit, you know? I said, Rich, it's the Philadelphia style. Yeah, that's good. Can you tighten it up a little bit?
Well, but the thing is that he still knew that you were gonna ultimately get him what he wanted. I think that was what I was trying to say.
Absolutely. I always felt, and Gayle, you probably did too. I always felt like I intuitively knew what he wanted. I felt like this stuff was, it just felt like a second skin. It just felt very comfortable. I could anticipate the way she sang, the inflections and the rhythmic inflections and stuff. It just felt natural to me.
And, did you have a guide vocal? You know, I know a lot of, there were, she cut a work lead a lot of times when they did those tracks, but I don't know what you know, there's always a preference, and sometimes it gets in the way of what's happening rhythmically when there's some any kind of counter melody or counter rhythm or something. And I just wonder how much of that you guys had to sort of envision as you were over. You know,
I wanted to hear as much of that before I did any recording. I wanted to hear it. I wanted to hear those vocals.
Me too.
And then a lot of times when I actually was recording, I didn't want to hear it. But I wanted to know what I was working around, you know.
That's important to know. You know, Karen liked it. She would sing a work lead usually when they were tracking the rhythm. Usually if Al was on drums or Jim Gordon or somebody, unless Karen was drumming, then of course there was leakage. So she wasn't going to sing a work lead while she was drumming, not in the studio typically. But it's interesting because then she never liked to go back and record the master lead until after the strings were laid down. She liked to at least have the strings in, and probably some of the overdubs that you did, Earle.
That I wouldn't know.
It's amazing how there's this synergy and the DNA of all of this, and the Carpenter records were so unique and very, and part of the reason why I called you guys both to do this is because, you both really were a staple in their sound. I mean, whether people that are listening fully grasp that or not, that's part of why we're doing this. But there are many musicologists, music, you know, historians that know you guys and followed your work. What are some of your other proud achievements that you've played on over the last, I mean, gosh, we're going back now, what, five decades, six decades? Earle, if you want to start, what are some of your other accomplishments that you most proud of?
Well, you know, it's funny. There are certain things will stand out, and then somebody will say, by the way, I heard such and such, and you sounded great on it. I don't even know what they're talking about. Sometimes I don't even remember the artist, let alone the song. Sure, and sure. The one thing, the number one thing that always comes to my mind when anybody asks me that question was an amazing fusion piece written by Klaus Ogerman. I can still, we recorded it in July of 1976 in Capital A. And at that time, the studios, you know, the television had a season and summers were slow. So this was a 60-piece orchestra and it was a who's who in town. And it's a fusion piece, jazz, rock, classical. It was George Benson, David Sanborn, Michael Brecker,
who's
were soloists on this thing, Joe Sample. And it's an amazingly successful fusion piece. It's a ballet. And that piece stands out more than anything. Is the number one thing. Doing that, we had talked earlier about Sending the Clowns with Barbara Streisand, and then the amazing arrangement that Jeremy Lubbock did, and Barbara just destroyed it. Which she'd been listening to Judy Collins' arrangement of it and had that stuck in her ear. Uh-huh. And so, and that was one of those, you know, let the copyist said, we'll write you a part for the introduction. And I said, I played the show. I know it by memory.
You got it right.
So, right. But yeah, I love doing television. I love doing dramatic television.
A Little House on the Prairie is one. I mean, you played on that. You played throughout that entire series.
That was the other thing that launched my career. They both happened about the same time. And it was a Little House and the Carpenters that really got me started in the studios. But I loved it because it was all fast paced. They didn't have time, you know, because the shows were on all the time. So in fact, I even remember doing one at Universal where we recorded, it was an 8:30 start in the morning, and that show was on that night, which meant, and this is before digital editing. Mm-hmm. And the editors had to have that show in New York at 5:00. Wow. And they did it. You know, really impressive. Those guys were good.
Nowadays have no clue what you guys had been through. And you pulled it off. It's really something. Earle, you mentioned that there's a story before we jumped into the interview. Can you share that with us?
Well, it was on a Friday afternoon that we finished Sending the Clowns. And so I was really tired. I went home and I woke up Saturday morning, the phone ringing. So I answered the phone and it says, Earle, this is Barbara. And I said, Barbara who? And she said, Barbara Streisand. And I'm, yeah, sure. And I just hung up. And of course the phone rings again. So they wanted me to come in and add a couple of things that, once again, this was stuff right out of the show. Mm-hmm. And so I went in and there was a little line, and the last note worked harmonically, but it was the wrong note.
Okay.
And so I said, you know, the last note is, no, that's the right note. Here, listen, played the track, and I was right. And Barbara said, see? So I said to the engineer, I said, look, let me put this down the way it's written and then with the last note different. And So we recorded it on two separate tracks, and I said, she can pick, and you can guess which one is on the recording. Wow. But, and then they put me on the wrong track. I went home, and I had to come back and redo it because they put the whole thing on the wrong track. And
And
it was on Saturday, when Saturday was golden time. It was a good day for me.
Yeah, I'll bet. How about you, Gayle? What are some of the achievements that you're most proud of?
Well, my relationship with Barbara started in the late 60s. So I've been her harpist for all these years. And I remember in the early 70s, we were on a session, rhythm section harp at Armin Steiner's studio here in Hollywood. And it wasn't a large room. And we were doing, this isn't really like an achievement, but it was just one of those, again, moments. And Barbara was in the booth just listening. She wasn't singing at the time. And so we were laying down a basic track. And at that time, Fender Rhodes was part of the rhythm section. And she wasn't getting the feel she wanted. And I was in an ISO booth. So we had 5-minute breaks at that time. And she had everybody take a 5. I said to her, the guys went out, and I said, hey, Barb, come over here. And I played something on the Rhodes for her. And I said, is this more what you're looking for? And she threw her hands up and she says, why does it take a woman to understand me? One of those wonderful moments. But we, Barbara and I have, I mean, everything she's done in LA, I think since the late 60s or early, very early 70s, I've been there with her. Mm-hmm. And normally the sessions are big, full orchestral sessions. And of course, and she sings, she'll be in an ISO booth. And so we can hear her. Mm-hmm. And I play to her because I know even if she's gonna overdub herself, she's gonna phrase it pretty close to what she's done. And because I've always loved accompanying, that's what I did so much on the piano in my earlier days. I need to hear her because I'm, like Earle said, I'm breathing with her, mm-hmm. you know? And when I'd leave a session, and whether it had been Jeremy Lubbock, who had done the arrangement, which would be superb. Of course, I remember one time Jeremy was very tall and he knew what he wanted. He was on the podium and Barbara came out and she wanted to try a certain line in a different section in the orchestra. And finally, he just looked at her and he handed her the baton. He said, here, you lead it. You know, and he walked off the podium.
Wow.
But it all worked out fine. But what I was going to say is when I would leave Barbara's dates, and they're all very near and dear to me, I couldn't put the radio on in the car because I wanted to keep in my heart and my being what I had just experienced for the last 3 hours or 6 hours, whatever it was. I didn't want anything to interfere with that. So needless to say, my sessions with her, sessions with Jeremy Lubbock, sessions with Don Costa. One of my favorite albums that I did with Don, because we had done several albums with Sinatra. Oh, Blue Eyes is back. Mm-hmm. But was a Kenny Rankin album. And it's called the Kenny Rankin album, and Don Costa arranged it. And his arrangements were absolutely superb. And of course, anything with Johnny Mandel was wonderful. And I think some of my shining moments for me in my heart when I think back are playing on so many of the Alan Menken animated features, starting with Little Mermaid, and just being so proud to have been a part of that whole time frame that I think started in the late 80s, from Little Mermaid to Aladdin to Beauty and the Beast, Hercules, Pocahontas, just the whole gambit that he had that was going on. I was very, very proud to be his harpist for that. And we're doing a new one now, which is a sequel to Enchanted. Now it's called Disenchanted. We did the pre-records for the songs, and we're going to score it in June, in about 3 weeks. And Titanic was another film that I was very proud to have been a part of.
It's hard to narrow it down.
It is. You know, Earle was mentioning about how fast we had to record for television, and he's absolutely right. American Style, Dallas, all of those wonderful shows. Angela Morley was another fabulous arranger. Yes. And Angela was like Jeremy Lubbock. I mean, they came out of the same mold, both from England. And whatever Angela wrote was absolutely right. And I so remember on one of the sessions we did for Dallas, and Stuart Kanin was concertmaster. And she had done one of the cues where she had written a beautiful solo for Stuart, and I was accompanying him, and the orchestra wasn't playing. And I just remember listening to him play and listening to what had been written, and the tears are running down my face, and I'm trying to still see the notes with the tear, because I get very emotional. You know, I become such a part of what's happening at the moment, you know, because of my ears, and I'm sure yours are too, are always in 360 degrees, and then of course all the rock and roll records, you know, being a part of the whole, you know, whether it was Motown or the David Foster. I remember doing my first session with David Foster, and it was going to happen at midnight because we were working around the clock. We were doing three sessions a day and squeezing in jingles. So David wanted to do a record that basically was built up from the harp, starting out with a harp track. And it was my first time meeting him. This was back in 71. And so I had to be in Hollywood. Actually, I think I was at Armin's studio at midnight. And we laid down a basic track. And then I didn't see David for a long time. And then I hear a record on the radio, and I thought, well, that's a really nice record. Gosh, I wonder who recorded that. I didn't know the group. The group was called Skylark. Mm-hmm. And I remembered the station and about the time it was on. I got home and I called the radio station. I said, you played a record. It was really, really nice. And he had said to me, the disc jockey had said, yeah, that was recorded. I think he said in England. Mm-hmm. I said, oh gosh, it's just so nice. And then shortly after that, I saw David. He said, we got a hit. I said, what are you talking about? And he said, the record that we did, Skylark, with the group Skylark, it was called, it was Wildflower. Mm-hmm. And he said, we've got a hit on it. And that was the beginning of my relationship with David. And he just, when that event that you and I were at for Richard, and David was there with his wife, right. Shortly after that, in fact, it was actually 2 days before the new year. So it was December, 29th, 2021. Mm-hmm. He actually sent me a platinum album for my work on that. And that's 50 years later.
He and I had lunch, mm-hmm. probably 2 weeks after you got that. And you came up in the conversation, excuse me, about 2 weeks after you
received
that platinum, he and I had lunch together, and your name came up in the conversation, and we talked about Skylark. And it was interesting because he sort of lit up when we got to that that conversation, and he thinks fondly of you. He thinks of you fondly and dearly. And I was just watching something on PBS not too long ago. It was a Christmas deal that you guys did together. And I remember thinking, maybe that's what it was. And I said, oh, I saw something on, and I mentioned you, and they had a lot of cutaways that they did, and they were on you. Anyway, but David's a brilliant producer and arranger, and he works a lot like Richard does too. That's what we were talking about. Because Richard would hear something, but Ron Goro, the late Ron Goro, would sit, and actually he was the amanuensis, the copyist, that would sit and write everything out. David does it the same way, where he'll sit and he'll play it all, and he's got somebody that actually does technical orchestrating. And a lot of people, they don't really get into all of that. They don't understand it unless this is the business that they work in. But I always thought that was because I have a very high regard and respect for David as well. So you guys, any memories? You shared one with me actually at the Wallace at that event, Gayle, recording with the Carpenters. And I'll ask Earle first, and I don't know if you would talk about that with your dog, Doheny. Maybe you don't want to tell that story. You don't have to if you have another one. But any memories that you guys have working with Karen and Rich that you want to share? Something that sticks out, something that...
Yep.
pops in your mind, Earle?
Well, so much of what I did, like I said, was alone. And nothing really stood out to me in regard to that as much as after Karen was gone. I remember, when she passed away, we had the sessions scheduled for the album a few weeks after. And of course he canceled them. And then I think we did that last album, which I really love. I think that it went back to the kind of stuff that I loved so much that Rich did in the beginning. I admired and I liked and enjoyed Peter Knight, but there was something really special about the simple transparency, the way that Rich arranged and wrote. And the last album has a lot of that, I feel, that feeling. It was really emotional, and I'm sure, Gayle, you recall that stuff. I mean, that, and also when we did the film, that Richard had never scored a film, mm-hmm. And you would never know that having sat there and worked with him, I said to him, I said, Rich, I'm still disappointed because he did, it was a natural, he just did it naturally, nailed the streamers and all the technical stuff. It was, pretty impressive.
He had been doing it. I've said that to him over the years. He's not particularly fond of the film in and of itself, but it's, I agree. I really wish he would have done more of that sort of thing. Karen told him that too. I mean, what a brave, ever branch out, and he considered it at one time and obviously never jumped on it, but.
He certainly could have done it. Gayle, I'm sure you agree about that. I mean,
he could have done anything he ever wanted to do.
Yeah. And that's having worked with the best in the business, Jerry Goldsmith, Elmer Bernstein, the best at the best. And Richard could have worked with those guys, in that league. He really could have.
Sure.
I agree with you. I think he had the capacity to understand film, but getting back to the records, what he did with the core group that did the vocals, and of course, Richard and Karen, they did a lot of overdubs, but just the harmonies, the close harmonies, it was so beautiful. And Earle, since you were doing mostly overdubs, you probably didn't know that from almost all of the sessions, their parents, Richard and Karen's parents, were always at the session in the booth.
They were there with when I was alone sometimes.
Did you get to play? Were you when she was getting married? Did you play for the wedding?
Yes. Yeah.
Do you remember that's right. Do you remember when she walked down the aisle and what she had worn, this gorgeous, beautiful dress and this beautiful hat? Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
She looked like a vision of out of a fairy tale. She looked so beautiful that day. Karen was. And I loved Karen. I really did love her. And I still love Richard. Yeah. Always will love Richard.
Certainly a life cut short. I think people underestimate just how vast their catalog. They were recording artists for 13 years from the time they signed with A&M until she died. It's amazing how much has been released since she's died. I mean, that just goes to show how much, and they were on the road. I mean, we talk about this in the book too. That was actually a sort of the foundation for a lot of the earlier chapters, was just how overworked they were on all of, they were doing 250 dates a year there for a few years. And to still find the time to go in and record these albums and all of the outtakes and the things that sat on the shelf for many years until, after Karen had died, it's really impressive. It's a shame, but we're blessed to have the music that we have. And of course you guys contributed to so beautifully. So.
And the magic of her voice was, even if you couldn't sing, anybody listening to her could sing with her. She had a sound and in a range that was just so near and dear to my heart. I mean, I absolutely loved her voice.
It was comfortable.
It was.
comfortable and effortless.
Yep.
You know, really was very special, very unique. Nobody like that.
Yeah, Richard was telling me a story not too long ago about a conversation that somebody had with the recording engineer Ray Gerhardt. Mm-hmm. He was Columbia, I think, before I think Herb pulled him in, and then so then he worked on a number of the Carpenter albums, and somebody said, what is the secret sauce, you know, to recording Karen? How is it that you get her to sound the way she sounds? And Richard loves telling a story, and Ray looked at him and said, I don't do anything, I take her into the board flat. Just she wasn't a loud singer, but she that microphone loved her voice.
It did. And, you know, their records are timeless.
Absolutely.
They'll never sound dated. Yeah. They're just a moment of beauty for 3 minutes or however long the track was that would be played. It's wonderful. I had an interesting experience years ago when I was married to my ex-husband, Artie Butler, who was a wonderful arranger and songwriter, composer. Yeah. And he had gone over to England. That's right. He was doing something, I think, it might have been Neil Sedaka or whatever. And it was since we had been married, it was the first time he was going to be out of the country since our marriage. So I got frustrated. So the next day I got on a plane and went to be with him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember what it was. He was going to be doing a show up in with Neil for a week up in the in Leeds at the Batley Variety Club. Yeah. So I got on the next plane, and there was an engineer that lived in England who had become friends in the day or so that with Artie, and he had taken Artie to the airport to pick me up. So he was driving. His name was John Kurlander, and John and I ultimately became very good friends subsequent years, but I hadn't met him before that. And I remember I was very tired after I arrived at the airport and got in the car. I was sitting in the back seat, and John and Artie are talking and da 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 da. And all of a sudden I hear John say to Artie, the one thing I haven't been able to duplicate or replicate is the sound of the harp on the Carpenters records.
No kidding.
Out of the clear blue. And I went, that was me. You know, and yeah, he said he's never been able to get that sound. And whether it was Ray, who was before Ray? Who was the young fellow that was before Ray, I think?
Well, Ray was the first. Well, Dick Bogert worked in mixing, but Roger is who you're
Roger. Yeah,
who you're thinking.
Roger, yeah. Right. Yeah. And then who went after Roger? I don't remember who the engineers were. If it was Ray,
Roger. Well, it was Ray and then Roger. The issue with Ray, and Ray did not like recording drums. Richard will be the first to tell you this, and he'll retell you this. He did not like to. Ray was suffering hearing loss apparently, and as they moved on through the 70s, and so what was happening is the tracks were getting very sort of mid-rangey, and that was when, because I think Roger got involved sometime around 72-ish when Earle arrived on the scene, and then he was a second engineer, and eventually by 74, 75, they moved Roger into the, started having him record the tracks, and so, but anyway, yeah, Roger, now that guy really had a set, so did Ray. I mean, they were amazing engineers.
Yeah.
And you're married to John Richards, I know he's credited on the Carpenters' old-fashioned Christmas, the second Christmas album that Rich did over in England when he and Mary went on their honeymoon. That was sort of the reason that they did it at Abbey Road. But John, a little tip of the hat to John, too. We don't want to forget him.
No, we would never forget him, because it was interesting. When he came to, I had a recording studio that I had built with my ex-husband, Artie, and Charlie Fox, and it was called Evergreen Recording Studios. And we had two scoring rooms, and we were doing really well. And at one point, Jerry Goldsmith, who was very, very close friends to Charlie, said, you know, there's a great engineer that you might consider bringing to your company. And Charlie says, well, who is that? And he says, fellow by the name of John Richards. He's in England and he's at CTS. The next time you go over to score a film, just check him out. And sure enough, Charlie was going to check out to score a film. And so on his last day in England, he went into CTS, and John had been remixing a film he had just done with John Barry. And the studio manager came in to John, the two Johns, and said to my John, there's a gentleman here, a composer, that would like to see the studio. Can you break away for a moment and show him the studio? And John Barry said, that's fine. And my John Richards went out and he meets Charlie. And needless to say, he said, I'm not really here to see the studio. I'm here to offer you a job. And he came to America with this huge, what can I tell you? I mean, his credits of what he had done in England. I mean, he was a master, and he was used to recording 100-piece orchestras. So we had to find a stage to be able to give him the facility that he was used to. So we took over the stage that had been dormant on the CBS lot here in Studio City. It was just holding props and things, and it was the largest stage in the country. Yeah. And we took it over, and it had been dormant for many, many years because I had recorded there before it shut down. And that really became the main room that John was able to record in, because he could have, you know, 120.
So you were definitely checking John out. I mean, not checking out his chops, but checking out his chops. Yeah, we get it.
Yeah. And the truth of the matter is, when he was at Evergreen one day, and I had heard so much about him, and I went into the control booth just to listen to how he was mixing or recording the orchestra that was there. And having worked with so many engineers, because now this is 1984, 85. And I just stood there and kind of took a breath, because coming over the monitors, what I was hearing was so beautiful without a lot of reverb, you know, just natural. And the musicians, the nicest compliment they would say to him was, I just love the way you make me sound. Well, he's just reproducing their natural sound. And if they're making a beautiful sound, that's what you want to capture. I mean,
I felt like Al Schmidt was very much that type of engineer.
That's
like Al, it was really sad to, you know, that whole story to see him go. I mean, granted, he was 91, I think, just shy of 92, or was he 90?
He was just shy of 91. And at the beginning of our getting together today, when I had to say, I need to take this call for a minute, that was his wife, because we're very, very close. And
yeah.
For all the years, I always called Al, and John did too. We always called him Uncle Al. I mean, he was a treasure to the record world. You know, he was iconic.
Well, so, those two guys, Al and John. John, by the way, is the most dignified and classy recording artist.
He's an Englishman.
Recording engineer. But whenever I saw either John or Al, I always knew I was going to sound better than I sound.
Oh, no. Earle, you've got such a big, fat, wonderful sound. You're beautiful.
He does.
Those guys were amazing. They really were. I remember when John first came to Evergreen.
Yeah.
You know, and I also, I'm like you, I had worked at CBS. You know, we did Hawaii 5-0.
That's right.
That's where a couple of big name guys got their start, as they were proteges of Morty Stevens, Bruce Broughton and Jerry Immelt.
Yes.
Wow. Well, before we wrap, Gayle, if you feel comfortable, you shared a story with me about your dog Doheny back in the 70s in studio. Hey, and we could leave this in, or we could take this out, but do you know what story I'm talking about?
I do know. Hold on one second.
Yep. Gail's gone. She doesn't want to tell the story.
This is a very faded picture of her, but it was about the time how old she was. Let me see if I can.
Oh, a German, German Shepherd.
No, she was an Irish. She was a Great Dane.
Yes, I see that. Okay.
Can you see it?
Sure.
It's very, very faded. Okay. So at that time, Doheny was about 6 months old. And I was married to Artie at the time. And she was my princess, and her name was Doheny, because we lived on Doheny, and she would go to a plethora of my record sessions. She was so beautifully trained, I could leave her choke chain on. In fact, the first night that I met David Foster, and I had long blonde hair, and it was the time of mini skirts and boots, and I go to the session at midnight, and I had gone home to get my dog because I knew I was going to be walking on the street in Hollywood, because they didn't, the studio didn't have a parking lot. So I went to get my Great Dane because I figured nobody's going to approach me with a dog that's this, almost as big as I am, you know? Anyway, so here was the session we're doing, and we had, it was a double for Karen and Richard. It started at 4 o'clock in the afternoon at A&M, and it was 4 to 7, 8 to 11. So on the break, I remember calling Artie and I said, you know, what are you doing? And he said, just hanging out. And I said, well, why don't you bring Doheny down? I know everybody would love to see her. And all the musicians knew her. So he said, well, we'll see. So sure enough, there was a set, one of the songs I wasn't on. So I walked out of Studio A and I'm sitting there in the lobby area. And I see the door open and it's Artie and Doheny. And I go, Doheny, right? And she comes romping over to me. And again, her legs are too long and she's not grown into her body yet, but she was just so precious. And she comes romping over and I'm hugging her. And what do? I open the door to, I don't know if you were there, Earle, but I open the door to go into Studio A and Hal Blaine's on drums. And he says, Doheny, sit. And she laid a pile of caramel colored diarrhea all over the floor. And he said, Hal says, Doheny, I said, sit. Yeah. And the whole orchestra exited the room, you know,
because
and I'm there and I'm totally aghast because my dog is perfectly trained, right?
Yeah. Well, maybe she just misheard Hal.
The dog was perfectly trained, but not Hal.
And I remember Jay Rosen, who was one of the violinists on the session, and he had gone out and he found a shoebox and some paper towels, and I'm shoveling all the, oh my God. Anyway, so I said to Artie afterwards, I said, what happened? He had forgotten to walk her all day.
She hadn't been out.
That's why she had been holding herself all day, and she was so excited when she saw me, and then she saw Hal and everybody. And, oh, well, anyway, needless to say, that was on Karen and Richard's date. And that was a moment to remember.
I'll have to ask Richard if he remembers that. I'm sure he would. All right. Well, this has been a pleasure, guys. I really appreciate it. And it's just, I mean, we could go on, and we might have to do another one of these. You know, it's really your catalog is so impressive. And of course, I don't think you really realize just how appreciated you are, certainly by the Carpenters community, but the world around. I mean, there's so many artists and film scores, movie soundtracks, and TV sound, you know, scores that you guys have contributed to, and people don't even.
And the Oscars,
the award shows and everything. So I just thought it would be nice to take a minute to celebrate you too and say thank you for all that you've contributed. And as you said, this stuff is timeless, and it's gonna, it will continue to live on for many generations, I believe. So thank you.
Well, we hope it's there forever and everybody will appreciate it forever. I know that your organization, when Earle and I and Al and I forget who else was there, when we went to the live event a couple of years ago, whenever it was. And I remember I stayed until the very end and was talking to all the people that were such fans of the Carpenters and their enthusiasm and their joy. The Carpenters will live on forever. And yeah. Earle and I were really privileged to be a part of their family.
That's the right word. The right word, privileged. Yeah.
Privileged and family. You guys, I think that's exactly why we're doing this, is because you very much are a part of that. And you will live on in the history books of Carpenters. And as I said, and many artists, but the Carpenters certainly. And I just want to thank you on behalf of all of the fans. So thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for having us. Good to see you, Earle.